Right, good afternoon. For the 12 of you who are here. It's raining, it's stormy, it's a Friday, you got your exams back. A lot of people are like, yeah, I'll take Friday off. I'm glad you're here. We'll talk about isentropic efficiency definitions for different devices. So we talk about isentropic relations, which are relationships we used to talk about keeping entropy constant. But then I keep saying that's not real. Those are just approximations that are useful. And now I'll start to show you how they're useful for actual devices, because actual devices have entropy. They have entropy generation, they have losses. So we talk about how to use the isentropic efficiency and isentropic relationships to analyze some of these real devices. So we'll start by defining isentropic efficiencies. Actually, do you have a piece of paper and a pen we can use to take a roll? Because I feel like they deserve extra credit for being here. So maybe we'll get some credit for them. But it's not going to mean anything until you're borderline at the end of the semester. Like, hey, they showed up where no one else did. They deserve something extra. But don't text your friends and tell them to show up, because it's too late. We can count how many here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. It's like 28 people, something like that. Thanks for coming. With the efficiency of the device, the rule is, we talked about before, the efficiency is always less than or equal to 1. The efficiency is always less than or equal to 1. Eta is a typical symbol for efficiency. And it's always less than or equal to 1, but really it's always less than 1. But by theoretical, it could be equal to 1 in some perfect cases, although we never found one. There are some devices that are pretty close. Electricity generators, like the magnets that make electricity, have like a 99% efficiency. So there's some devices that are pretty efficient, but it's always less than 1. We start by looking at a turbine, which we've analyzed before. A turbine is a device that expands a gas. The gas comes in, then the gas goes out, and it gives you a work that's out. And that work out is equal to the change in enthalpy from the incoming to the outgoing. So you have a lot of enthalpy in the incoming working fluid, and the enthalpy drops. So leaves a state 2 with less enthalpy, and the difference between the enthalpies is your work out. And the efficiency, by definition, for the turbine is equal to the work you get out actual over the work out for the isentropic case, the isentropic case being the perfect case. So the isentropic work is a perfect work, the actual work is less than the perfect work, and the ratio of the two is your actual efficiency for the turbine. It's the fraction of the ideal work you actually extracted out of the system. Buzzing. It was not a tornado warning like it was earlier. If we draw this on a TS diagram, TS diagrams start to become more relevant now that we're looking at isentropic efficiencies of devices. We've been using PV before, but now we're using TS. We have a saturation dome here. We have one isobar and second isobar. And for a steam turbine, you're starting off with high pressure, high temperature steam that's in the gaseous phase, like superheated steam, and it's condensing out through the turbine. It's cooling off into the saturation dome in some cases. You start off with condition 1, might be right here, and you go straight down to 2. And we call this the 2S, the isentropic case. For an isentropic expansion through a turbine, your entropy doesn't change. And so on the S axis, it's a straight line because your entropy is not changing. That's a perfect turbine where you're dropping your enthalpy, you're dropping your temperature, you're extracting energy out to give you work out, and do so in a straight line, a straight vertical line because it's isentropic. But your actual case comes over here. Your actual turbine isn't perfect. The entropy increases. It moves to the right. On the s-axis, your entropy goes up through the turbine because of friction and losses and heat transfer and other things that are happening. You might have an error system called 1 prime and 2 s prime, and a real error-based system would be 2 a prime. So if it's a steam turbine, you'd be near the dome, but if it's like an air expander, a gas turbine, you'd be out in the superheated region. So there's a difference between actual and isentropic. There's a difference between reality and perfect. in the perfect system, we can approximate as a straight line, but in reality, it's going to go to increasing entropy. It's going to move to the right and the down. But there's something important I want you to see here. The pressure for 2s is the same as the pressure of 2a. The pressure for 2s prime is the same as 2a prime. The pressures are the same. The pressure ratio is the same for the perfect device as for the real device. The difference is in the temperatures. The temperatures are different. So one way to write this is the pressure of 2s is equal to the pressure of 2a. The pressure of the isentropic exit is the same as the actual exit. The pressure ratios are the same. But the temperature of the isentropic case is not equal to the temperature of the actual case. And this is where the isentropic relationships become useful. We can use isentropic relationships to figure out what the pressure is at the back end of the system. And then once we know the pressure, we can apply some other relationships like the efficiency to figure out what the actual temperature is. And once we know the actual temperature, we know the actual enthalpy. Once we know the actual enthalpy, we know the actual work. But the pressures, we assume to be about the same. So that's a very important idea to have in mind. That's for our turbine. And the efficiency is less than one. The actual work you get out of a turbine is less than the work you could have gotten had it been a perfect turbine. Let's take the same idea for a compressor or a pump. And a compressor or pump has work that goes in, so it's work in. We'll start, I'll start the pump now, I'll show you the compressor a little later. Before I do that, any questions on the turbine? Any question on anything I've drawn? Perfect. Let's take a pump. So there's a pump, and we have some fluid coming in, some fluid coming out. We have some work in to operate the pump, to elevate the pressure. The efficiency of the compressor, by definition, is inverted from the turbine. It's the perfect work over the actual work, because an actual pump requires more work than a perfect pump, because we have to overcome the friction and the head losses and the turbulence, all that kind of stuff. So the actual work is larger than the isentropic work, so it's on the denominator. It's flipped. So over here, it's actual over isentropic. For a compressor or pump, it's isentropic over actual. Isentropic is the smaller work. The actual work is larger. And so you need the efficiency to be less than one, so that's a gut check on it. You have to put in more work than you wanted to. And if you draw that on a TS diagram, you have your iso bars. Going from 1 to 2S, it's isentropic, you go straight up. But for the real world, 2A is over here to the right. Your entropy is going up and to the right. So a turbine, you're dropping your temperature and pressure and extracting work out. For a pump or compressor, you're putting work or enthalpy in to drive up the pressure and temperature. And again, your pressure at the second state equals the isentropic case is the same as the actual case. But the temperature of 2S is not equal to T2A. In the process of raising the pressure, you also raise the temperature of the device, and you might not have wanted that. For a pump for a liquid, the work in, the isentropic work in, equals the volume times the change in pressure. The volume of the liquid doesn't change much. It's an incompressible liquid, so the volume is constant. So it's just the volume times the change in pressure. That's the isentropic work. But the work in for an actual system is the isentropic work divided by the efficiency of the pump for liquids. So the efficiency of the pump might be 0.9, 0.8, something like that. You're dividing your isentropic work divided by 0.8, you're actually getting something greater than your isentropic work. That's the same as saying work in isentropic over the efficiency of the pump. That's a delta P here. For a turbine, your work out actual is less than your work out in the perfect pump. You're getting less work out than the perfect case. But for a compressor, your work in actual is greater than your work in isentropic. For a pump, you have to do more work than you wanted to. And where the isentropic approximation comes in handy again is finding those pressure ratios. Any questions about the pump? Let's look at the nozzle. You have your nozzle, you have your inlet condition, you have your outlet condition, you have, say, pressure one, temperature one, velocity one, coming out, maybe you have P2, and you want to know what your exit velocity is for your design system. And your efficiency in this case of the nozzle is your actual velocity squared over your perfect or isentropic velocity squared. You're going to get less velocity out of your nozzle than you want because you have losses along the way. It's not perfect. So your efficiency is still less than one. And for a nozzle, on the TS diagram, you're dropping the pressure from a high temperature, high pressure gas to a lower temperature, lower pressure gas. And your actual system has greater entropy and is further out of the right axis than your isentropic condition, than your perfect condition. That temperature difference is equal to the change in enthalpy, is equal to the velocity you get. The bigger the temperature change, the bigger the enthalpy change, the more velocity you're going to get out of the system. Over here at the turbine, the bigger the change in temperature, the bigger the change in enthalpy, the bigger the amount of work you're going to get out. And the pump, the bigger the change in temperature, the bigger change in enthalpy, the more work you've got to put in. So work, changes in work are equal to changes in enthalpy. Changes in velocity are equal to changes in enthalpy. And we always have this distortion, where for a real cycle, we're going off to the right on the TS diagram. I'll do some examples, but any questions on anything I just wrote? We're going to start to do a lot of these device analyses as we look at cycles. Cycles are coming up. In cycles where you learn how to make engines go and learn how to make electricity, you learn how to get power, you learn how to do refrigeration, that kind of thing. But let's take an example of a steam turbine. This isentropic efficiency example for a steam turbine. And we're given a steam turbine. Write down the givens. We're given an adiabatic steam turbine and steady flow, steady state. And we're told there are negligible changes to kinetic potential energy. Now we're given a condition one that is 3 megapascals and 700 degrees Celsius. We're also given that the efficiency of the turbine is 85%, 0.85. And we have some exit conditions where it's 10 kilopascals at the exit pressure, but we don't know the actual temperature or the actual quality for this steam turbine, and we want to find work out. We might even ask the question, what is m dot so that the actual work out, the rate of work out, equals 100 kilowatts? So we're given some information at state one, state two, state adiabatic, state flow, state state. Negligible changes to kinetic potential energy. We've got some pressures, we've got an efficiency. We want to know things like what the final state is, what the workout is. And for a steam turbine, and you're gonna have to know this kind of thing. That's what we expect. You have your dome, you have your pressures, you're dropping the pressure across the turbine from high pressure to lower pressure, and usually near the dome. You're going from 1 to 2S or 1 to 2A. That should be a straight line with the 2S line. You don't actually want the water vapor to condense out. You want to keep it outside of the dome if you can, or else you get water droplets. They ruin the blades of the turbines and that kind of thing. Let's start with that. We'll do a mass balance. So mass balance. M dot one equals M dot two equals M dot. Okay, that's good. Energy balance. What are all the energy terms coming in for this system? And you'll get to a point where you just know it. How should I start?
Entropy.
Entropy what?
Well, we know what H1 is, but we can't find H2 and O.
Okay. What's the generic format you use to set that up with?
M1, H1.
Equals, right,
M dot one, H1.
Okay.
Equals M dot one times H2.
Okay.
Plus I do M dot times one.
Okay, perfect. Yeah, that's your energy balance. And the M's cancel out. So there's no kinetic energy terms or potential energy terms. We sense any backs of their Q. It's just a change in the equals your change of work. So you work out from 1 to 2 equals H1 minus H2. So this is, sorry, so sloppy. Work out from 1 to 2 equals H1 minus H2. And for your note cards, for your next exam, these are the kinds of relationships you're going to want to want. You want to know the relationship for an adiabatic turbine. If you want to know the relationship for an adiabatic compressor, that kind of thing. Maybe even set up the energy balance so you see how it was derived. Now that's only true if it's adiabatic. So if it weren't adiabatic, it'd be transferred, there'd be a Q somewhere in there as well. So the change entropy, you're coming in with enthalpy, you're leaving with less enthalpy, the difference in the enthalpy got converted to work. Where did the enthalpy go? It went to the work. So work out is H1 to H2, and your power out
is just M dot times your work out.
This over here. Let's look at first the isentropic case. So, by the way, I haven't denoted yet whether this is actual or isentropic. This is just a generic, bless you, a generic energy balance. So, let's look at the isentropic case, the perfect case. Let's start with perfection and then get worse in there, kind of like my collegiate career. Start off perfect and then got bad, you know, in semester one. I thought that was funny, but you guys did not laugh. So the isentropic workout is H1 minus H2S. So I'm just using the same equation but substituting the isentropic notation for H2 here to get the isentropic work. When you have the isentropic change of enthalpy, you get the isentropic workout. Well, what do we know about H2S? We know that S2 equals S1 because it's isentropic. And it's at E2. We're assuming the pressures are the same, and therefore we can determine state 2S. So we can determine state 2S, which means T2S and X2S. And we can look out from the table what S is. S1 equals 7.7571 kilojoules per kilograms Kelvin. Just looking that up from the table. The steam table. We have the mixture. Then you would have X2S equals S2 minus SL over SLB. And H2S equals HL plus X2S. HLV. Same kind of equation used before for water. All right, so now we know because it's isentropic and we know the pressure, we can find everything about the isentropic state 2, but we also know the isentropic state 2 is not the real state, it's just something we're using to find the actual state. Well, how do we do that? Well, we know work out from 1 to 2 isentropic, well, we could say work out isentropic case equals H1 minus H2S. And we know the work out of the actual case equals H1 minus H2 actual. We don't know H2 actual yet. But we also know that the actual work out equals the efficiency times the isentropic workout. And we can find the isentropic workout because we know the isentropic enthalpy difference. So we can find the actual workout. And what's the actual workout, the change in the actual enthalpy? So then we get this equation, we'll put this all together. The change in actual enthalpies is equal to the efficiency times the change in isentropic efficiencies. I'm just plugging in the definition for actual work and actual isentropic work there. And that gives us H2A. Once you know H2A, we know everything. Or it might give us X2A, the actual quality. So we can use the perfect approximations plus some other information like the efficiency of the turbine to deduce what our conditions are. So if I have P1 equals 5 megapascals, P2 equals 10 kilopascals, or oh, I did 3, sorry, 3 megapascals, or 10 kilopascals, and you're dropping state 1 to state 2 actual, like that, and that drop, that change, you think of this as a change in energy, because that's the change in temperature, and we're taking that energy and turning it to work, so the work comes out of that drop in temperature. What happens if P2 is 300 kilopascals? So it's not 10 kilopascals, let's say instead of 10 kilopascals. So if it's dropping to 300 kilopascals, we call that P2 prime. It's stopping partway through, we'll call that 2A prime. What does that mean for your workout? You get more workout or less workout? You get less workout. You're dropping less. This is, you think of changes and drops in temperature as drops in enthalpy. And the greater the change in enthalpy, the greater work you get out. But if you didn't drop the enthalpy that much, that means you still have a lot of enthalpy in the exiting fluid instead of the work. So at the higher back pressure, you get less work. This is a problem of back pressure. If you take your car and you cover up the tailpipe and you put back pressure on it, you'll get less work out of your car engine. If you take a gas turbine on a plane and you put back pressure on it, you'll get less work out of that plane. If you have a steam turbine at a power plant and it's not very cold and low pressure on the backside, you have back pressure, it kind of inhibits the turbines and you get less work out of it. Have you ever seen the movie Beverly Hills Cop?
Yeah.
1985, where he puts bananas in the tailpipe? It's a real thing. Put back pressure on the engines. Can't get the exhaust out. You get higher pressure, you get less work out. So back pressure is a problem. And so you want to get the lowest possible pressure possible. You want to take from high temperature, high pressure gases to low temperature, low pressure gases. The big changes in enthalpy that you can use to drive your work out of the system. The other way around for compressor. Well, the way around, like the more work you have to put in to get those big changes. So we're starting to use our isentropic relations to analyze a real device. I'll give you an example of an air compressor also, but any questions on what I just showed you?
Jeff, I think we should get a clip of Beverly Hills Cop for the app.
Okay.
Yes.
So the big delta T is why the lab up on the sixth floor is using liquid nitrogen. Is there cooling the exhaust rather than heating up the whole room?
Yeah, you want as cold a heat sink as possible to take the heat away from your device and get more power out. This is constantly an issue. So there's a lot of research in Dr. Bogart's lab. He's a professor, he's got a lab next to my group. And they invent ways to cool turbine blades to keep the turbine blades from melting. But also, if you have cooling on the back end, you can go from high temperature, high pressure to lower pressure, high temperature, you get more work out of your turbines. The better the temperature difference, the better the efficiency, the better the performance. So you want higher temperature combustion and lower temperature cooling. You want to spread those temperature differences apart. Actually, we're gonna talk about that in the lecture on Monday, about heat engines and using temperature differences to get a lot of work out. Liquid nitrogen is really cold, so that's one way to get the really low temperatures. Liquid nitrogen is impractical for airplanes and things like that. But, yeah?
So that's why then your car has like a radiator and all that, right? Is it to increase the efficiency?
Yeah, you want cooling, absolutely, yeah. You also want to keep certain parts from melting, that kind of thing, so you want cooling in your car. In that case, it's air cooling. Air passes over the radiator. There's a coolant loop, so there's liquid in there, but it's really air blowing over the coils that cools off. Have you guys ever seen a Tesla? Have you noticed the front of a Tesla, what it looks like? It's got a solid plastic piece. It doesn't have an air vent on the front because it doesn't need air cooling. So they can design the front different. My car, most cars, have a grill on the front because they need air to pass through the engine over the radiator to be cool.
The air conditioner still needs it.
The air conditioner, their air conditioner, I think, is just a compressor, but I don't think they use air cooling. So I don't think they have an air. They have an air. You have an air intake for your vents, but you don't need air intake to cool your engine.
You still need a radiator for the compressor, for the condenser.
Probably pretty small though, right?
Yeah.
But cooling a car is very different than cooling the engine, I would say. So if you see a Tesla, it's got the T on the front. It's not just the T that's there; it's a solid piece. Notice that it's solid. There's no air intake for it. A muscle car will have a big intake up front to get more oxygen for the combustion inside the system, but also for the radiators for cooling.
We haven't talked about Carnot yet, have we?
No, we'll do that on Wednesday. Okay. All right, let me talk about a compressor. I'm trying to figure out what kind of car I should get. My car is 11-year-old Ford, so I feel like kind of due for another car. And I'm trying to figure out if I want an electric car, a natural gas car, a hybrid, or like an Alfa Romeo, like just a normal, just a fast car. And my son, who's 9, says Alfa Romeo. And my daughter's very sensible, wants me to get an electric, like Ford C-Max, it's 100 miles per gallon. So I'm trying to figure this out. Do you guys have any recommendations for that?
A
reliable car or a fun car?
Yeah.
I drive 9,000 miles a year, which is less than normal. I commute to work and back, and that's about it. I drive to Houston and Dallas periodically. I usually rent a car for that, but I can take my own car. So I don't drive a ton, but I tend to drive in neighborhoods, and so you can't go too fast in neighborhoods, but there are some curves and some hill country roads I do every once in a while. So I kind of want a fun car, but I also have dogs and a kid, so I don't want my kids to have fun. So I can think of it. Like right now I've got a Ford Escape, which is like got cargo, it's very practical, right? It's not kind of a stiff ride, it's not that much fun to drive, but it's really useful. I don't know. Yeah, Jeff's got
electric BMW, small SUV.
There's an electric BMW small SUV. There are fuel cell, yeah, so I've tried to figure out if I want to pay $80,000 or $130,000 for a car. Probably not, but it's on my mind. There's the electric, you know, like Chevy Volt and that kind of thing, but it doesn't C5. So I want a C5 so I can take my family if I have to, under duress. I want cargo area for the dogs. I want to be fun to drive. There aren't many cars that meet these requirements. There are some natural gas cars out there, but the Alfa Romeo, for some reason, Alfa Romeos have a horrible reputation for maintenance, but the new four-door one is the fastest four-door car you can buy. It goes 160 miles per hour, and I don't never go that fast. But somehow, I'm intrigued by owning a car that can go that fast.
Porsche Cayenne.
What's that?
Porsche Cayenne.
This one's faster than the Porsche Cayenne. The Alfa Romeo is a diesel that goes faster than the Porsche Cayenne, and it gets like 38 to 40 miles per gallon because it's a turbo diesel. And so I'm thinking the fuel-efficient race car that seats five is the way to go. The other thing is the Alfa Romeo Giulia, and my wife's name is Giulia, so I thought that'd be kind of fun. But I'm not sure if that will fly in the Weber family. We'll see. I'll keep you posted. I'm thinking about it. And these efficiencies matter for that. Like the efficiency of the car. I care a lot about fuel economy. I got my Ford Escape because it was a hybrid. So it was an SUV that got 38 miles per gallon. I really wanted that. I want a fuel-efficient car with cargo area, with long range. Like I want a car that doesn't exist, basically. But we'll see if it comes on the market next year. So
I was going to buy the VW.
right? Because it's diesel and clean and gets like 50 miles per gallon, that kind of thing. But then the scandal came out, so I'm not sure if it might be that. You guys follow the story of the scandal?
Yeah.
You know, like people are gonna go to jail for this and stuff, right? So the VW diesels are efficient, but dirty. We're gonna learn about that in about a week and a half. Diesel engines are very efficient, which is great for fuel economy and carbon emissions, but they're dirty. They put out soot and NOx, and NOx is nitrous oxide, can kill you and cause acid rain, that kind of thing, so it's bad. But they put a trap on it that would trap the NOx, it would scrub the tailpipe. But that hurts your zippiness of the car, and it hurts the fuel economy. So they turn on the trap just when they're being tested by the EPA for emissions tests, but they would turn it off when you're driving normally. So you're driving normally, you don't know you're polluting, it feels fast, or good acceleration, good fuel economy, but when you're doing the test, it would be less, have less acceleration, and be cleaner, if people don't know this. And this is against the law in a variety of ways, like this is fraud. And so the total cost of the company might be like $50 or $70 million. Like VW might not survive as a company for this, we'll see. And people like me who are about to buy one, I'm like, wow, I'm gonna try that now, so then after I got it, so we'll see. So there'll be people going to jail, we'll see how it goes. And it turns out, it's not low level people going to jail, it's like the head of engineering for Audi and the head of engine design for VW might be the two guys who go to jail, something like that. So pretty senior guys. And it might be they made promises to their CEO that they couldn't deliver on, so they cheated instead. So we'll see. These are all allegations, it'll take years to figure it out. I don't know why I'm telling you all that, but it's on my mind. Anyway. Let's take our compressor. And for a compressor, you got work going in. We draw our compressors like this because it's squeezing the air. We draw turbines like that because they're expanding the air. So if you, well, I don't have a turbine up here. So they have a slightly different shape. And that's because of what's happening. The air comes in, it gets squeezed, so it's smaller. So we show that physically that way. And if you look at an actual compressor, if you go to look at a jet engine with a shell taken off or to a power plant, the compressor blades actually fan in like that. They slope it. And on the back end, you got P2 and T2A. In this case, you want to find where the work in is. And you might be given the case to find, you're given the actual conditions, find the efficiency of the compressor, which is equal to the work of the compressor that you would put in isotropically versus the actual work in. All right, let's start with the mass balance. N.1 equals N.2 equals N.0 because it's a steady flow, steady state device, so we can say. Assume steady flow, steady state, adiabatic. Next, we'll change this to kinetic and potential energy. Then we want to do our energy balance. What's the energy balance? Same as what we did before. Your work in equals H2 minus H1. It's a change in the enthalpies. You're coming in with low enthalpy fluid, you're adding work to make high enthalpy fluid. You're converting from work to enthalpy. Your actual work equals H2A minus H1, and your isentropic work would be H2S minus H1. And this is an air compressor, so it's air, it's not steam, it's not a mixture. Well, what do we do? Well, we know that for these systems, the pressure is the same. So P2S equals P2A. But T2S is not equal to T2A. The pressures are the same. And we want to find the efficiency. We know the actual temperature, and we know the actual and the isentropic temperature. Well, we can use our P0 functions that we learned, was it last time or two times ago? P0 functions. For ideal gases, you can use the P0. We just made up this term, P0, and you can use it for isentropic analysis. So you can use this for isentropic gas analysis for ideal gases. P2-naught over P1-naught equals P2 over P1. In that P2 ratio is the same as P2S over P1 equals P2A over P1. Just by the way, we're setting this up with isentropic analysis, the isentropic pressure ratio is the same as the actual pressure ratio. And because of this information, we know P2A, we know P1, we can find the P0 ratios. We can go to table 5. Table 5S, or table 5E, and find P0. this information gives us P2 naught and T2S and HS. In that T2S, we you can get this ratio, and then you can have, once you know T2S, you have all the information you need, to H2S and everything else. So it's error, you have actual conditions, you want to find the efficiency, you need to know the isotropic conditions to know the efficiency, you can find the isotropic conditions for the isotropic relations. Among the isotropic relations are the P-naught functions, which you can use for ideal gases, and then you can find your perfect conditions. Your actual case here is H2A minus H1, and you can find your efficiency is by definition, your efficiency of your compressor equals your isotropic work over your actual work. That equals H2S minus H1 over H2A minus H1. This is a good formula for you to know. For an actual adiabatic, steady flow, steady state compressor, they're all steady flow, steady state.
Dr. Weber, why is that ratio, like I get why it works for the isentropic case, but why does it also work for the actual?
It's so it's really working for the pressure ratios are the same, but by definition, our isentropic pressure ratio is the same as our actual pressure ratio.
Okay.
So this is a key thing. Your entropy really shows up with temperature effects, not necessarily pressure effects. Your entropy really shows up with heat transfer and temperature things, more than pressure things. You don't get entropy from work, including PdV work, it's not a pressure effect. Yeah. But you do get it from heat transfer, which is a temperature effect. And if we want to draw it, dying. You're going from 1 to 2S versus 1 to 2A. Pressure ratios are the same. Temperature ratios are not. I think I got time for one more problem. Here's a quick joke before that. We have to look this up, Jeff, and add this to the app. Now, here's a tough guy in an alley, and a kid goes to him. No, let's not say a kid, let's say a sophomore. And says, hey, I hear you're a guy who solves problems. Well, I've got a real problem. I think he's like going to hire him as a hitman or something. He goes, here they are, working on it together. All right, so if we assume that the turbine is isotropic, then we can interpolate the outlet entropy to find the enthalpy at that state. Okay, it's hilarious. So they're actual cartoonists doing thermodynamics jokes for us. That was relevant for today. And let's look at a turbocharger. For a car. I think it was a Saab who made the first turbocharger. Saabs are a Swedish car. They also make jet engines, and they make turbochargers to give a little boost to the car to compress the air. Saab is one of those companies I expect to go out of business entirely any day now. And for a while, they were the largest exports from Sweden until ABBA, the rock band, overtook them as the largest export in terms of financial value to the country. You have a turbocharger where you have your car engine here, giving you power out to your wheels through your axle and your transmission, all that kind of thing. But you still have hot gases at the back of the car. If you put your hand at the back of the tailpipe of the car, it's still hot. Well, you could use that heat to extract more power by sending it through a little turbine, which then drives a compressor, which gives you higher air pressure and more airflow in your engine to give you more power. So it's a way, that's a turbo charger or turbo compressor to charge the engine with a little more oomph. Oomph is a scientific term. And that is a way to extract energy out of the exhaust. So turbochargers give you a little more kick to your car engine. And we can analyze how that might play out. So here's a problem from a book. Turbocharger boosts the inlet air pressure to an automobile engine. It consists of an exhaust gas driven turbine. So the exhaust gas drives the turbine, directly connected to an air compressor as shown in this figure. For a certain engine load, the conditions are given in the figure. Assuming that both the turbine and the compressor here scratched out are reversible and adiabatic. So instead of assuming that they're perfect, assume that they have an efficiency of the turbine of 90% and efficiency of the compressor of 70%. Those are typical numbers. having also the same mass flow rate, so study flow study, say calculate the turbine exit temperature and power output. Find also the compressor exit pressure and temperature. So we have a variety of conditions given there, and we have actual efficiencies of the compressor and the turbine. We can analyze the system. How do we do that? So let's go through that.
Is the work out from the turbine going into the compressor?
The question is the work out of the turbine going into the compressor? The answer is yes. So the turbine is there only to drive the compressor. The turbine's not driving the wheels of the car. It's only driving the air compression to get you more air into the chamber, to give you more kick out of the pistons, to give you more work into the wheels. And it's also true for other types of engines, like a jet engine. You have a turbine there to extract power out of your hot gases. You burn your jet fuel, but you burn just enough jet fuel. You take just enough heat out of the jet fuel with the turbine to drive the compressor. And the rest of the hot jet fuel goes into the nozzle to use. So it's not unusual to have a turbine there just to drive the compressor. Okay, let's look at the turbocharger example.
This turbocharger, the turbine and the compressor connected on shaft.
They've got a rotating shaft that are connected, yeah. So they're usually physically close to each other. It's a solid rod that spins. If you go to a power plant, I don't have a tour set up for us, but everyone's going to take a class on a tour of the UT power plant. The power plant main floor is, I don't know, twice as long as this room and twice as wide. It's a huge floor with a high bay. And they have a compressor and, in some cases, a turbine on the same area. And it's got a long, you see a rotating rod between the shaft between them. So the compressor and the turbine are connected to each other. So how do we analyze this in this case? Do the turbine first. And then the compressor. And we're given at state 3, P3, and T3. We're given a state 4, pressure 4, and we're given the efficiency of the turbine is 0.9. And we're also given mass flow rate. Is that right? Was that written on there? Yeah, mass flow rate is 0.1 kilograms a second. And we want to find the work of the turbine and the actual conditions for this system. What do we know? Ow. Over on the screen. No, sorry. Hurt my little thumb here. We know the efficiency of the turbine is the work out of the turbine over the isentropic work, the actual work out of the over the isentropic work. And we know that the work of the turbine actual equals H3 minus H4 actual for a typical adiabatic turbine, which is usually desired. Usually you don't want your turbines to give you heat, you want them to give you work. So you design them to be as adiabatic as possible. Well, that's too cold, by the way. We do, I'm jumping ahead, that's my energy balance here. The work of the turbine actual equals H3 minus H4A. We can use your P-naughts to get H4 S, and that is P4 naught over P3 naught equals P4 over P3. And we know that P4S equals P4A, but we also know that T4S is not equal to T4A. And so we can relate this with our isentropic system to get the work of the turbine actual equals the efficiency of the turbine times the work of the turbine isentropic, which is saying that the work of the turbine actual, the actual workout, is the efficiency of the turbine times the difference in the isentropic enthalpies, which is H3 minus H4S. That's equal to H3 minus H4A. Just doing some algebra on this. So we can back calculate to get T4. isn't given in this case. So these are P-naught relations. We know the pressures are the same for isentropic as an actual. We can figure out the enthalpies that are actual versus isentropic, and then back out T4. And for what's happening for that turbine, is you're dropping the temperature and pressure from T3 to T4S to T4A, but you have some increase in entropy along the way. So we analyze the turbine first using the same relationships we just did and using P-naughts because it's working on air. So it's working on a gas in roughly ideal conditions. So you can use your P-naught for ratios. You can also look at a compressor. Now that we've analyzed the turbine, and in this case, we're given P1 and T1, and we know that the actual work of the compressor in equals the actual turbine work out. So there's work into the compressor. Actual equals the actual work out from the turbine, answering that question earlier. So we can use that relationship as well. We want to find P2 and T2A. Well, what's the work of the compressor actual in? That's H2A minus H1. Based on what we found earlier, the change in enthalpy. You're putting work in to drive the enthalpy up from low pressure, low temperature, and therefore low enthalpy to higher temperature, higher pressure, higher enthalpy. And again, we can use P1 naught or P2 naught. In this case, it would be P1 naught equals P2 over P1. And then that gives us T2S and H2S. So we have an energy balance to get your equations with your work and your enthalpy. Use your isentropic efficiency and relationships to connect these. We know the efficiency of the compressor is the isentropic work over the actual work. So we know the isentropic work equals H2S minus H1, which is the same as the efficiency times the actual work. Then you can start doing some fun stuff. Well, I think it's fun anyway. The isentropic work of the compressor equals the efficiency of the compressor times the actual work of the compressor. Which is equal to the efficiency of the compressor times the actual work of the turbine. Because the actual work of the turbine is the same as the actual work of the compressor. Then we can solve for H2S. One more substitution for what the actual work is. It's the efficiency of the compressor times the efficiency of the turbine times the isentropic work of the turbine. That was fast, went through a lot. Any quick questions on that before we go? You're using your efficiencies, your P-naught relations, your isentropic relations, your energy balances, your mass balance, put this all together to look at real devices. So we're finally there, real devices. Any questions? All right, have a great Halloween, and then we'll see you Monday.